Good evening, everyone. In this session, we'll be talking about raised ICP and brain herniation. You know, in any patient with a head injury, or a brain tumor, or an infarct, or raised. Or an infarct, or an intracranial bleed. What is the final cause of death? The final cause of death is an increase in intracranial pressure, which causes an injury to the brainstem and other vital structures and finally leads to death. So any physician, or a physiotherapist, or a surgeon, it becomes very essential for them to identify the features of raised ICP and take an immediate measure, because it's any evidence of raised ICP as a medical emergency. So in this session, let us see what is raised ICP, intracranial pressure. What are the symptoms of raised intracranial pressure? What are the radiological features of raised intracranial pressure? And what are the various kinds of herniation? How to recognize them, and how do they cause death? So let me share my screen. What is a normal? We will be basically answering these five questions. What is normal intracranial pressure? What is Munro-Kelly doctrine? What are the symptoms of raised ICP? What is Cushing's triad? And what is brain herniation? So let us answer the first question. What is normal intracranial pressure? You can remember that the normal intracranial pressure is around 10 centimeters of mercury. So any value above 10 means an increase in intracranial pressure, but 10 to 20 is a borderline where we can manage medically sometimes, but any value more than 20 is a life-threatening value. So what you have to remember, any value less than 10 is normal intracranial pressure, 10 to 20 line is borderline, elevated but borderline, and more than 20 is a really increased pressure, which is life threatening. So once before I tell you how does an increased intracranial pressure cause death, you need to know what is Munro-Kelly doctrine. And so what is Munro-Kelly doctrine? You know, our brain is surrounded by skull, and skull is a rigid structure. It's not elastic. So skull is a rigid structure. And what are the components within the skull? There are three. We have the brain tissue, we have the blood, and we have the CSF. So basically the skull, which is a non-rigid structure, harbors three components: brain tissue, blood, and CSF. The volume of any of one structure in this thing increases, the other things get compressed. So suppose there's a brain tumor. So the volume of the brain increases. So what happens? As an initial compensatory mechanism, the volume of CSF decreases. The CSF comes out of the skull into the spinal cord. So this can accommodate around 5 to 10 millimeter of mercury. Beyond this one, any increase in volume of the brain will have to compress the blood, or will have to compress the brain. So this compression of the brain or this compression of the blood will cause further injury to the brain. So am I clear? So the Munro-Kelly doctrine says the volume within, because the skull is a rigid structure, the volume within the skull is fixed. If the volume of the brain increases because of an infarct or a bleed or a brain tumor or anything, the intracranial pressure increases because of the rigid skull. This causes an immediate decrease in the CSF, as a compensatory mechanism. But when the CSF is displaced, further increase in the volume compresses either the blood or the brain. This compression of blood will lead to ischemia. This compression of brain will cause direct brain damage. So this causes final damage to the brain. And so what are the symptoms of raised intracranial pressure? Headache with projectile vomitings. What do you mean by projectile vomiting? That is an headache which comes as if it has come from nowhere. Usually when the vomiting is because of some other reason other than raised ICP, patient will have a nauseating sensation before vomiting. Whereas in raised ICP, patient will not have nauseating sensation. He suddenly vomits off. This is known as projectile vomiting. So any headache with projectile vomiting is a sign of raised ICP. And particularly when the vomitings are more in the morning, this is more a sign of raised ICP. Because the intracranial pressure has a diurnal fluctuations and intracranial pressure is more in the morning. Second symptom is blurring of vision. Why do you see blurring of vision in raised ICP? The cerebral subarachnoid space is in direct communication with the optic nerve. So any pressure within the brain will get transmitted to the optic nerve, and this causes swelling of the optic nerve. This is known as papilledema. This papilledema causes blurring of vision and transient visual obscurations. And third one is irritability and decreased sensorium. Patient will start become drowsy. This obviously because raised ICP will put a pressure on the brain parenchyma and then will put a pressure on the reticular activating system, leading to decrease in sensorium. So you'll have to remember, headache with projectile vomiting, blurring of vision, and irritability and decreased sensorium are the cardinal symptoms of raised ICP. And so what is a Cushing's triad? The Cushing's response refers to changes in the body because of raised intracranial pressure. So the Cushing's triad includes hypertension, bradycardia, and apnea. All these things, our blood pressure and our respiration, are controlled by the brainstem. So when you see the Cushing's triad, it means that the brainstem is being compressed. So Cushing's triad, when you see this Cushing's triad in the patient with a brain pathology, you can say that the patient condition is very serious. At any moment, we can lose the patient. The patient can deteriorate at any moment. So this is a medical emergency which you have to act upon immediately. So once you have understood what is raised intracranial pressure, let us understand what is brain herniation. So as I have told you in my previous sessions, this is brain, which is divided into various compartments. Just a moment. So as I've told you before, the brain is divided into different compartments. This is a tentorian cerebelli, which divides the brain into supratentorium and the infratentorium. And similarly, the brain is divided into left and right compartments. So what I meant to say, brain has a number of compartments which are interconnected with each other. Before I go further, you will have to identify a few things. This part, a medial edge of the temporal lobe, is known as the uncus. This uncus is in very close relation to the supracellular cistern and the brainstem. So you have to remember what is uncus and why is uncus important. The uncus is very close to the supracellular cistern, which contains the circle of Willis, and it is also very close to the brainstem. This is the inferior part of the cerebellum. Can anyone tell me what is the name of these structures? I'll wait for a second. This structure is very important. This is the inferior part of the cerebellum. What do you call that? This is known as the tonsil. So this is a part of the cerebellum which is in close connection with the foramen magnum. And this is the spinal cord. The brainstem becoming continuous with the spinal cord. This is the lower part of the brainstem. That is what you remember. So the uncus is related to brainstem, upper part of the brainstem, and tonsil is related to the lower part of the brainstem. So these are the cerebellar tonsils. So I have shown you, this is the brainstem. Our brainstem has three components. The upper part is the midbrain, middle part is the pons, and lower part is the medulla oblongata. And this is the cerebellum. Okay, so our brainstem is having three parts. This is a normal CT brain. You can see the supracellular cistern. The supracellular cistern is in the form of a pentagon. I have told you in my last seminar, it has five limbs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this is the brainstem. So this is a normal appearance of a normal CT brain. So before I go into the type herniation proper, let me tell you the types of herniation. So this is the Fox cerebrum. So when there is a mass lesion, it compresses one hemisphere of the brain onto the opposite side. So this hemisphere herniates below the Fox cerebri onto the opposite side. This is known as a subfalcine herniation. Second one, I've told you what is the uncus. Uncus is the medial portion, middle most part of the temporal lobe, and it is in close contact with the brainstem. So when the uncus herniates, it comes out and compresses the brainstem. So this is known as the uncal herniation. What is temporal herniation? This is the diencephalon. This is the thalamus and the hypothalamus. So when there's an increase in pressure, this goes down through the tentorial notch. This is known as the central tentorial herniation. What is D? This is extracalvarial herniation. This is you commonly see after a decompressive craniotomy. Decompressive craniotomy is done whenever as a measure to decrease the intracranial pressure. It's an emergency surgery. You remove a part of the calvarium so that the brain herniates outside. So the resultant pressure on the brain is decreased. And the final one is a tonsillar herniation, where the cerebellar tonsils are pressed down by the increased intracranial pressure through the foramen magnum, compressing the brainstem. And that is known as a tonsillar herniation. So of these things, what is very important for us is the central tentorial herniation and the tonsillar herniation. So I'll be telling you regarding the central tentorial herniation and the tonsillar herniation. So first one is the tentorial herniation, and it is also known as the axial brainstem herniation. So as I've told you, the thalamus and the hypothalamus, the mid portion of the brain, when there is an increase in intracranial, it pushes the brain down through the supratentorium, down through the tentorial notch. So because of the pressure, the brainstem starts failing sequentially. Initially, the midbrain takes the pressure, then the pons, then the medulla. So similarly, you see findings, you have symptoms which are along this one. So first one is the midbrain. So what happens when the midbrain is involved? So basically there are four phases. The diencephalon is the midbrain. So you have the early diencephalic phase, the late diencephalic phase, and the pontine phase and the medullary phase. So you know what are the contents of the brainstem. The most important content of the brainstem is the reticular activating system. And what is the function of the reticular activating system? It activates your, it's responsible for your awakeness. When you sleep, reticular activating system sleeps. When the reticular activating system is activated, you become conscious. So because of the increased intracranial pressure, the increased intracranial pressure applies pressure. So because this application of pressure on the brainstem, the reticular activating system within the brainstem gets suppressed. So what happens after suppression of the reticular activating system? Our level of consciousness decreases. We become drowsy. So this is the first sign of central tentorial herniation. So decreasing sensorium is the first sign of central tentorial herniation. Second one. So apart from the sensorium, what else do you see? We look for pupils. We look for the posture. We look for the kind of respiration. So what happens to pupil? You needn't remember the correlation of what kind of pupils are seen in which phase of herniation. You just remember these are the sequence of changes which you see in the pupil. So as the herniation rises, as the herniation increases, first the pupils become small, but they continue to react. So whenever there's an herniation, the first sign within the pupil which says they become small. So when you are looking at the patient at the bedside, you are doing your physiotherapy for a bedside patient. If the both the pupils are small, you can infer that there is some kind of herniation present, provided we have ruled out influence of medications. Next, what happens? In the next phase, the pupils become mid-position. That is, they appear somewhat a normal size, but they don't react. So the first stage, the pupils have become small. In second stage, they have become mid-position. See, as the herniation effect has reached the mid of the pons, the pupils become mid-position and fixed. Can you guess what happens next? What happens to the pupil? Now they are not reacting, they are mid-position. I'll wait for 5 seconds for the answer. So next stage is a terminal position. So what will the position of the pupils in this position? I'm looking for your answers in the chat. Right. In the next stage, the pupils become mid-dilated and fixed. So when you see a patient with mid-dilated and fixed pupil, you can come to an inference that the entire brainstem is non-functional. There is an insult to the entire brainstem. So at this position, the patient is in a very serious condition. So what is important? You have to identify the initial stages when the pupils have become small and reacting. So when the pupils are small and reacting, there is increased ICP, the herniation has started, but still you may be having some time to save the patient. So first one was a decrease in sensorium. Second sign which you have seen was changes in the pupillary reaction and signs. Third one, what will you observe? Third important one is kind of respiration. So again, you need to correlate this You need to remember which stage of herniation and how well is the respiration. You just identify what will the abnormalities of the respiration and what is more abnormal than the present one. So normally your respiration has a rhythm. There's an inspiration, there's an expiration, and the rhythm is uniform. In the earlier stages of herniation, occasionally the patient will show yawns. It takes a big yawn occasionally. So when you are on the bedside, particularly when you are in an ICU setup, when you are giving physiotherapy to a patient at the bedside, if the patient has occasional yawns, this may be a sign of early sign of cerebral herniation. So what happens? Even though the respiration is regular, but occasionally patient is having yawns. In the next stage, what will happen? Patient will have a regular respiration, but progressively the inspiration expiration reaches a peak, and again they become small, and there'll be apneic interval. Again, the respiration expiration will increase, they reach a peak and small. Can you identify this pattern? So respiration, small expression. Gradually they increase in intensity, amplitude. Gradually they reach a peak. Again, they become small and reaches an apnea. Again, after apnea, again the intensity increases and comes down. This is because here in this particular stage, the brainstem responsiveness becomes automatically dependent on carbon dioxide. So when the carbon dioxide, when in the apneic phase, the carbon dioxide builds up. So as the carbon dioxide builds up, it stimulates respiratory center. So the respirations gradually increase. When the carbon dioxide is washed out, the respiratory centers become, there is no stimulus for the respiratory center. So again, the respiration increases because at this point of time, the respiratory centers have become autonomic. They are not receiving impulses from the supratentorium. So they become, it's a reflex reaction to the carbon dioxide buildup in the body. So you needn't even remember what is the cause of cane stroke pattern. You will have to identify what is cane stroke's pattern, and you have to recognize that this pattern of respiration is a very bad sign and the patient is in imminent danger. Next stage. In this stage, even that responsiveness to carbon dioxide is lost and patient will have a sustained hyperventilation where the amplitude and the frequency of ventilation increases. And in the final stage, patient respiration becomes shallow, rapid, and finally patient will have apnea and death. So what are the four phases of respiration? Occasional yawns is the first sign. Cane stroke's respiration is a easily identifiable and a definite sign of brainstem injury. Next stage is sustained hyperventilation. Last stage is shallow and rapid respiration leading to apnea and death. Am I clear? Fine. And the next thing which you'll have to watch is the posture of the patient. Whenever this, as all of you know, the basic control of the supratentorium is inhibitory to the toe. So when the supratentorium is cut off, the supratentorium is no longer controlling your tone. The tone within the reflex R becomes automatic, and because of the reflex R, the tone increases. So initial phases, because of increase in reflex activity, increase in the pyramidal activity, the tone increases. The bilateral plantars become upgoing. In the next stage, there's an increase in tone in all the four limbs, but the upper limb achieve a flexor posture. This abnormal flexion of the upper limb with abnormal extension of the lower limb is known as decorticate rigidity. This is known as the decorticate rigidity. And in the next phase, the patient extends the upper limb. both the upper limb and the lower limbs are extended. So this is decerebrate rigidity. And in the next stage, patient become decerebral flaccid. So once their tone is completely lost, it means the entire brainstem is not functional. So what are the four stages? In the first stage, there is in the plantar responses become extensor. In the second phase, the patient will adopt a decorticate posture. In the third one, he will adopt a decerebrate posture. And finally, it will become flaccid. And next will be the dorsi response. I know everyone knows what is a dorsi response. When you, in an unconscious patient, when you move the head to one side, reflexly the eyes move to the opposite side. This is dorsi response. If anyone of you has played with a Barbie doll, you will understand this one. When you rotate the Barbie doll to the right, the eyes reflexly move to the left. When you rotate the Barbie doll to the left, the eyes reflexively move to the opposite side. This happens in an unconscious patient. This response cannot be seen in a conscious patient. So normally when the patient is unconscious, but brainstem is intact, the dorsi response are symmetrical, smooth, conjugate. Initially they become very loose. So when you move, it becomes more easy to elicit. In the next stage, it becomes a deconjugate. One of the eye doesn't move, only one of the eye moves. So when you find this is an easily recognizable sign. When you find that one of the eye is not easily moving, it means the dorsi response has become abnormal. And in the medullary phase, no response is seen. The eyes become fixed. So again, this means that the brainstem is not functional. So you can go through this table later on. This is a small table where I have maintained all these things so that you can compare. So how does the consciousness get impaired in the stages? What happens to pupillary size? What happens to pupillary reaction? What happens to respiratory pattern? What happens to the motor response? You have to identify that something is abnormal. So what is more important for you is neither the sequence nor correlating the which sign correlates with which phase of the hernation, but what is important is to identify that particular sign and its presence, because its presence is an emergency sign. You don't have much time to take action. You have to take action immediately. So this is one picture where I've shown you basilar artery. And from the basal artery, you can see small perforators, which is giving the supply to the pons. Okay, so in raised ICP, because of the pressure, the brainstem slightly moves down and there is shearing pressure on the perforators of the pons. This causes infarcts in the brainstem, bleed in the brainstem, which are known as durate hemorrhages. You can say small hemorrhages. And these durate hemorrhages are causes of death in central tentorial herniation. So let us go to uncal herniation. So can anyone tell me what is uncus? I've told in the beginning of my session. So uncus is a part of which part of the brain? Is it part of the temporal lobe or the frontal lobe? I'll wait for your answer. This is actually a break before I go further. Go back and show you. So actually I'm asking, what is this? This is uncus. So uncus is a part of the temporal lobe. So uncus is in very close contact with the brainstem. So what happens in uncal herniation? Suppose there's a temporal lobe lesion. This will push the temporal lobe to one side. So this is going to push the temporal lobe. So this temporal lobe will cause pushing of the uncus, and this uncus will then push the brainstem. So this is known as uncal herniation. So let us go back to uncal herniation. Uncal herniation. So what are the symptoms of uncal herniation? Let me first elaborate. You will be observing the same thing. First one is you will look at pupils. So pupil can either show constriction or dilatation in the later phase. Patient will have contralateral hemiparesis. Sometimes they can have ipsilateral hemiparesis. I will explain you why. Depression of consciousness because of the compression of diencephalon. In the late features, you will have symptoms similar to the central tentorial herniation. So these are the lateralizing signs. So why is there constriction of the ipsilateral pupil? So this picture shows our third. And this one, which I'm showing in blue, is known as the uncus. This is the uncus. The uncus, I have told you, the uncus is very close to the brainstem. In that is the region where the third nerve also courses. So when the uncus compresses, initially compresses the third nerve, which is the oculomotor nerve. When there is initial compression of the oculomotor nerve, it gets stimulated. So the stimulation of the oculomotor nerve causes constriction of the ipsilateral pupil. So the constriction of the ipsilateral pupil is the first sign. Then when the compression further increases, the oculomotor nerve becomes non-functional. So whenever a nerve is getting irritated, it becomes hyper-excited and works more. But when the compression increases, the excitability decreases and it becomes hypofunctional. So initial stage of uncal herniation, because of irritation, oculomotor was hyperfunctional and the pupils become small. In later stages, it becomes hypofunctional and the ipsilateral pupil dilates. So the dilatation of the ipsilateral pupil is the first sign of uncal herniation. If you have any doubts, please type on the chat so that I can address to your doubts in the later portion. So when the oculomotor nerve further becomes damaged, even the third nerve becomes completely infunctional and the eye pupil dilates and the eye deviates downwards and outwards. So in uncal herniation, suppose the patient has an EDH on the right side. Initially, right side pupil becomes small. Then the right side pupil becomes large. Then the right side eye deviates downwards and outwards. So these are the pupillary signs of uncal herniation. Second one, why does it cause hemiparesis? So one of the important signs of uncal herniation is contralateral hemiparesis. You can see in this picture, this is the uncus. This uncus is compressing the midbrain or the crest cerebrae on the right side. So when the crest cerebrae on the right side is compressed, it causes weakness on the opposite side of the body because of the pyramidal decussation. So this patient will have weakness on the opposite side. So this patient has left-sided extradural hematoma. So this left-sided extradural hematoma causes right-sided hemiparesis. So this causes right-sided hemiparesis. So this is one sign, but there is a catch here. Suppose the pupil is dilated on the right side, the lesion is on the right side, but that has a localizing value. A dilated pupil has a localizing value, but hemiparesis doesn't have a localizing value. Why? Because sometimes what happens is when Ankus pushes the brainstem gets pushed to opposite side and it gets compressed against the opposite side tentorium. So suppose in this example, left side Ankus will push the left side of the brainstem. The brainstem will go to the opposite side and the right side of the brainstem get compressed against the tentorial node. Because the right side of the brainstem is compressed, it will cause an hemiparesis on the same side. So in a raised ICP, because of uncal herniation, hemiparesis can be present on the same side. Hemiparesis can also be present on the opposite side. Even the hemiparesis is present on the same side, it is because of the paradoxical shift of the brainstem to the opposite side against the tentorial cerebellum. This is a false localizing sign, and this is known as a Kernohan's notch phenomenon. You can see in this picture, the Ankus is pushing brainstem to the opposite side. This brainstem is getting compressed against the tentorium. Because the right side brainstem is getting compressed, it causes hemiparesis on the left side. This is known as Kernohan's notch phenomenon, and this is known as a classical false localizing sign. So hemiparesis can be false localizing. So you don't try to localize the mass lesion on the basis of hemiparesis. You will be localizing the side of lesion on the basis of the dilated pupil. If the dilated pupil is on the right side, the hematoma or the infarct or the bleed is present on the right side. This is the basic thing which you should never forget. If the both the pupils are dilated, then it means it's the terminal stage of the brainstem compression and probably it's in the medullary phase of brainstem injury. As I've told you, uncal herniation causes depression consciousness. This is because of the compression of the reticular activating system. Now let us see what are the radiological features of herniation. I've told you a number of times in my previous sessions. Whenever you see a brain, first thing you will have to say is the suprasellar system. The suprasellar system is shape of a pentagon. 1, 2. On the opposite side, 2, 3, 4, and this is 57. Okay. When the entire pentagon, the suprasellar system is preserved, that is, there is no compression on the brainstem. You can see the brainstem over here, clear. Okay, and this system which is seen is the ambient system. That is, there is CSF present all around the brainstem. So in uncal herniation, what happens? The Ankus projects this way. So the suprasellar system, which is a symmetrical pentagon, becomes asymmetrical. One of the side of the pentagon gets truncated. Second one is this ambient system, this CSF space gets obliterated. So these are one of the two early signs of uncal herniation. Can you see this? So there is some lesion over here in the temporal lobe. So this pentagon, one side of this pentagon, the suprasellar system is truncated by the Ankus. This is no longer a pentagon now. You can see it is getting truncated over here, this way. And when you compare with the opposite side ambient system, the ipsilateral ambient system is also obliterated. In the later stages of herniation, because the circle of Willis gets obliterated, it can cause occipital infarct. Even the presence of an occipital infarct with a patient with a raised ICP is a very grave prognostic sign. Final thing I'm going to tell you is a tonsillar herniation. As I've told you, the tonsil is the lowest part of the cerebellum, and this part herniates through the foramen magnum into the spinal cord. So what are the symptoms of raised ICP? As in any other thing, there is a decrease in sensorium. Second one is patient will have opisthotonus. That is, patient will have a stiff neck. He it will hyperextend his neck and it will keep it both the hands and legs very rigid. So this opisthotonus posture indicates the patient is having tonsillar herniation. And other symptoms are nearly similar to other things. Patient will have vomitings, the respiration becomes irregular, finally will have apnea, there'll be some changes in the eye. So radiologically, you can see this is a tonsil which is herniating through the foramen magnum. I want to show you one, two, or three examples. You can see this lesion, there's a bleeding in the temporal lobe. You can see truncation of the supracellular cistern. There is obliteration of the ipsilateral ambient cistern. So this patient is having tonsillar herniation. I mean to say uncal herniation. Similar one, the truncation of ipsilateral ambient cistern. Hope I was able to tell you what are the symptoms of raised ICP, what are the signs of raised ICP, what are the radiological features. Let me complete my session here. In my next session, I will be trying to teach you what are the different kinds of bleed, mainly the extradural hematoma, subdural hematoma, contusions, and all these things in my next session. Thank you.